You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C Show. Glad you could join us. Don't forget about raindaily.com. What am I talking about? Check it out, www.raindaily.com. And also, if you're looking for something to do on February 27th and you're in Western New York area, check out JKJ Boxing and their next event, which is taking place at the Syracuse Holiday Inn. Visit www.jkjboxing.com to check out the card and get yourself some tickets online and all that happy stuff. Now, you don't have to get tickets online. You can get them at the door. But either way, make sure you tell them Billy C sent you and demand the Billy C discount. Well, every week, it's time for
Blast from the Past.
We shine the spotlight again on fighters from years past.
Rocky Marciano, top ranking. Joe Lewis is the leading contender.
And upset by Mr. Carver, the greatest.
Joe Frazier with a left hook.
Good right hand thrown by Foreman that time.
Look at that left
that
hook.
That belt that goes to Ray Mancini.
It's Blast from the Past on Talkin' Boxing.
And this week's Blast from the Past, which is being sponsored by KOFantasyBoxing.com. Check it out, www.KOFantasyBoxing.com, features a very interesting character, a former world bantamweight champion, Pete Sanstol. And joining me right now to tell us all about Pete Sanstol is my man, Alex Perpalli. What's up, brother?
Good evening, Billy C. How are you?
Oh, not too bad, not too bad. I'll save it for later. We got some stuff we can talk about later. But right now, we got an interesting guy for the blast this week, Pete Sanstol. And I actually stumbled across this guy while we were doing our last blast from the past. And some interesting things pointed me in this guy's direction. And I thought he was a pretty good choice. Tell us about him.
Yeah, he's an interesting guy. We had done him once before, I think it was back in 2014.
Did we?
Yeah.
I don't remember him at all.
Neither did I.
Really? Oh, okay, okay.
So when I looked it up, I said, oh, wow, we have done him.
Oh, wow. Because he's not in the Hall of Fame. I mean, he's not in the International Boxing Hall of Fame, which is kind of surprising when as we get to his accomplishments in the ring.
Right, and I think, I thought this was by design, because we've had a couple of guys that were similar to Pete in the sense that they had recently that we've done. Yaki Lopez was kind of like this, where they had defeats, they faced other Hall of Famers, but they lost. And, you know, I think that this is something you've talked about before. Forgive me if I start coughing. I feel a cough in my throat. You do wonder about this new age of fans today, if guys like this will be lost, because I don't think there's the same sort of fighter today in to some degree that, or at least they don't get as much credit because guys tend to pad the records with lesser opposition. You know, he's more of a guy who is a top rival that you fight a couple of times, and he doesn't quite make it. You know, Yaki Lopez was like that. He was right there in the top, ranked in the top 10 of his weight class, but he never became the champion. He had a couple of shots, but never quite did it. There's another guy we just did recently that I'm completely blanking on. But, you know, I mean, those guys, I guess, sometimes they get in to the Hall of Fame if they happen to be on the ballot a year that there's none of the recent guys, you know. Because it's always the guys who are freshly retired that get the first votes.
Well, this guy was sort of like the anti-Yaki Lopez. When we were talking about Yaki Lopez and his punching power and you know what a warrior he was, this guy was a warrior as well, but he did it kind of in the more of, you know, need I say, because, you know, so many people have different interpretations of the sweet science, but this guy had a lot of hand speed. He was very hard to hit. Which is indicative of him lack of knockouts, actually. And he also was aggressive, you know. So here's a guy that was a good defensive fighter, but he was aggressive with hand speed. And, like some of the other fighters that we talked about with the blast from the past, he never seemed to run out of energy, and he fought in a time when, they weren't just limited to 12-round fights either.
Right. I think that's what definitely made him so popular and why, I bet you a lot of if you're somebody who, the kind of fan who likes the is the old timers, likes the golden age type fighters, this is a guy that, of course, when you hear his name, oh, my God, Pete Sanstol. Yeah, because, he was all the bantamweights would have him on his on their records, of the age. I think that definitely is counts versus something that people don't think of as often today.
You did hit it on the head. He did fight in that golden age of bantamweights, when bantamweights were very popular. And there were so many of them, and they were all really good. And he fought right in that era, and fought a lot of the guys, that were known for being tough, like similar fighters to Panama Al Brown that we talked about last week, Speedy Dotto, Eugene Hoyt, I think that's how you say his name, Benny Schwartz, guys like that he fought. And like you mentioned, Young Perez, like you mentioned, he fought them multiple times as well.
Right, exactly. And that's what really is different from today compared to then, back then. To give the formal outline of him, Pete Sanstol, his birth name, Peter Oli. I don't know. I don't know the vowels of Norwegian, so... I'm not sure if that's Ole or Oli. Sanstol. Some of his nicknames were the Blonde Tiger, Baby Cyclone. He was born March 28, 1905, and fought. He was Orthodox and 5'3.5". Born in Moy, Norway, which was a fishing village, that was one of the things I, there is one clip I did find, and it's interesting. It's of him sparring for maybe a minute, maybe not even. He spars with another fighter who I didn't see identified on YouTube. And it is interesting. I'll definitely post it because it's interesting about how, how we talked about Panama Al Brown last week. This is the two of them sparring. It's sort of an exhibition. There's definitely a pretty sizable crowd there. But you could see what we pointed out last week, the dramatic physical appearance of Panama Al Brown. He really is black licorice stick. Pete Sanstol, like you said, yeah, very, he's... comes forward, throws a lot of punches, bobbing, weaving, fast, not a hard puncher at all, a consistent puncher and a active fighter. A lot of description of his style is fast, a whirlwind. He could protect himself almost with his offense. There was fights where he'd get cut and then... rather than hang back and just keep slipping, I mean, he could do that at occasion, but he would, keep throwing punches so you're not going to be able to throw at him. He would just bleed and throw punches. So you're right. He would have incredible amounts of energy and fighting out of Norway and some of his fights were there. The rematch with Panama Al Brown late in his career was in Norway. And of course, Norway has that strange relationship with boxing, even though this guy who was an all-time great came out of there. Boxing has been banned in Norway, I believe, since 82 in the wake of Duku Kim. And I know talk about political correctness and sort of liberalism gone mad, where it erodes rights. It has been barred from that country. People like the great Cecilia Brakus, a female fighter, is from there, but doesn't even get to fight there. But they did have this history. It's interesting because he even seemed to get his start in some of Pete Sanstol's amateur fights were through, like, scholastic programs. So even the school had, was had an involvement with boxing. They must have seen it as another athletic event that, you know, that the youth did. But 82... I don't know how it went down, but that's when they banned boxing.
Well, they're just to get off topic. They are trying to bring it back. There is some legislation in place where they're real close to having it return, which would be good. But anyway, a lot of great historians throughout the sport of boxing have labeled Pete Sanstol as one of the great bantamweights. I mean, he's compared with guys like Terrible Terry McGovern and Petey Kid Herman and Kid Williams. I mean, you know, these are all guys that we've done on Blast from the Past, and as a matter of fact, they're all Hall of Famers. You know, I mean, he won several awards from the Ring magazine throughout his career. He was in some very high profile fights in which some he won and some he didn't. He did win. You know, it's interesting to see even how they look at his career, which kind of seems a little flaky to me because for all intent purposes, he won the world title on May 20th, 1931 in Montreal, Canada, when he won a 10-round decision over Archie Bell, although BoxRec doesn't show it like that. But, in other, Ring, like say the Ring magazine, they show him winning that title and having successful defenses that later that year and retaining that title all the way up until a unification of sorts. He had won the, the NBA's version of the bantamweight title when he beat Archie Bell in 1931. And then when he fought Panama Al Brown in August of that year and lost a very disputed decision, which we talked about last week, Al Brown walked out of there with the NBA and his own title, which was the New York's version of the world bantamweight title. And he never regained the title again after that. He did get another shot, but he never regained the title again.
Right, and yeah, that fight with Panama Al Brown. So you're right. So it was sort of like the consensus unification at the time. That was for all the marbles at bantamweight, that did start a little relationship there with him and Panama Al Brown because they ended up fighting two more times, one more time. I'm sorry, because their fight actually was canceled several times. They had postponements. Yeah, I'm sorry. One of the fights had been canceled, and then it was postponed. That set, when they finally did have the rematch, it was in Oslo, Norway, and it was sort of weird because there's a lot of discrepancies of when that fight actually took place. BoxRec says 35, and evidently Fight Facts says 34. It's interesting because the first fight broke records in terms of attendance, and it was the biggest hit fight in history in Montreal, and the rematch was a pretty small attendance in Oslo because, you know, boxing, I guess, wasn't quite as big there in 35. That was one of his later fights, and he did defeat Brown in that fight.
Some people refer, you know, we're talking about his style, aggressive, throws a lot of punches, never runs out of gas. There were people, including Nate Fleischer, who compared him to Jack Dempsey, which is amazing considering that Jack Dempsey was a knockout puncher and Pete Sanstol, of his 96 wins that weren't newspaper decision wins. He only had 27 knockouts, 24% ratio, which is, you know, how do you compare a guy with Jack Dempsey, who was a, you know, vicious killer, you know? And the Eyebrow in 2006 in their journal actually rated him out of all the best, out of all the bantamweights ever, as of 2006. He was ranked number 21, which is pretty high considering all the bantamweights that had laced on some gloves.
Yeah, 21, that is, I mean, it's definitely respectable, but I think that's where you do see that, okay, then that could be reason why he's not quite in the International Boxing Hall of Fame quite yet, and why, unfortunately, this is the kind of guy that could get end up getting forgotten if the sort of trends we're seeing in the Hall of Fame voting continues, you know, where I think a guy, I mean, I know you like him, but... guys like Riddick Bowe and Ray Mancini can get in. You're gonna. There's gonna more likely the voters are gonna forget about the Pete Sanstol.
Well, wait. This goes back to why a guy. No. Listen. This is why I feel that the Hall of Fame shouldn't just be about like you make a great point about, especially Pete Sanstol. You know, he fought the guys, the big name guys, and came up short, right? So you say to yourself, you know, we talk about this with Marlon Starling and Donald Curry, you know, why they might not get into the Hall of Fame. But, you know, when you look at a guy like Boom Boom Mancini or, you know, other fighters that are in there that people, you know, have a tendency to not think, it's the impact that they made, and I believe that Pete Sanstol, because this is the perfect example of back in that era why boxing was a trade, because Pete Sanstol, not only was he a very successful amateur, he turned pro, then the guy was a manager, he was a gym owner, he was a promoter, he did all of that. I mean, this guy was a boxing, he was in the boxing business, and that's something that we don't have today, I think.
Right. I think that's, he ended up right. He stayed in there his whole life, in boxing his whole life. He became a referee as well as a promoter.
Right, he was a ref, too. That's right.
Yeah.
You know, so...
Yeah, I mean, I think we do see instances of that, but perhaps not quite on this kind of a level where he did all of it.
And the guy still, he fought Sixto Escobar in 1935 when he was way past his prime, and he still went the distance with the guy. You know, I mean, you know, Escobar is a Hall of Famer, isn't he? Sixto Escobar is a Hall of Famer, you know. And when he fought him, he was 25. Sixto was 25-9 at the time. And I know he's got way more wins now. So obviously it was early in his career. Well, not now, but I mean, he finished his career with a lot more wins. You know, so I mean, he fought him early in his career. And Pete Sanstol was at the end of his, you know, and he went the distance, you know. So, I mean, he never was stopped, right?
No, I don't think he was ever stopped, right?
Right.
I think we're talking about four Hall of Famers here with one win over them. We have Panama, Al Brown twice. We have Sixto Escobar. We have Midget Walgast.
Yep.
And I think he lost to all of them, except, like I said, he did avenge himself against Panama Al Brown.
Speedy Dotto, he had a draw
Speedy
with him.
Speedy Dotto, he's another Hall of Famer, correct? And Emil Spider Fladner is, I believe he is a Hall of Famer, too.
Yeah, you know, so I mean, and he had the draw with Dotto, you know, so I don't know, you know, it just seems... Seems a little crazy, but this guy is somebody that shouldn't be forgotten, in my opinion, because of the impact he made, not just in the ring, you know, before his pro career, and then he stayed with it. You know, I mean, he just
well, and I think that's what I was, and I think maybe you're saying the same thing, is that in terms of impact of the sport, Ray Mancini and Rick Bowe, they were two real popular guys that got a lot of people to watch boxing in their eras, and. I think he did too. It's just that because it wasn't TV, this was a time when there was no TV.
But that's not his fault,
right? You know, exactly. I think he was popular, and I think that's why. Where it's unfortunate that today's voter they might not do the reading to see, oh, wait a minute, look at this. Here they are, the paper's talking again about, you know, Pete Sanstol. And, you know, but they will see who was on CBS every weekend. Oh, yeah, it was Ray Mancini.
Yeah, but look at Arturo Gatti. Arturo Gatti was a situation where a lot of people felt that he shouldn't have gotten in. You know, although he was a world champion, a lot of people felt that he shouldn't have gotten in. When people asked me, I said, well, I feel that Arturo Gatti deserved to get in because of the impact he made on the sport. You know, yeah, he came up short in some of the big fights, but he was such a warrior and so memorable. You know, here we are remembering him because people can punch him up on YouTube, and they can't with Pete Sanstol, you know. So it's a shame, and hopefully, you know, they'll get some interest in these guys. I mean, you know, I think this was another one of these guys that went away to the Army in World War II. You know, so you're looking at a guy in with 113 pro fights, almost 20 years of boxing. And, by the way, he served in the Army in World War II. You just don't see that anymore.
Right, and he actually served, I believe it was, he served for us. Which was interesting because he had been Norwegian. We'll talk about a patriotic guy. He lives here, and he lived in Brooklyn, and he considered himself an American. And,
yeah.
But he did. I was just going to say something. I just lost my train.
I think he died in Brooklyn too. He had a series of strokes and passed away. I believe in his 70s. How old was he when he passed away?
I think it's 76.
Yeah,
and 1982. Yeah, it was. He did have a little dementia, as we see in so many fighters in the last 5 or 6 years of his life. He actually donated his body to science, which I thought was an interesting little footnote there. But yeah, there is that. I was trying to think of, you know, whose style he's like today, and I think that's the thing that's difficult, is maybe a young Paul Spadafora, because a real speedy but defensive also, and slickly defensive, exciting guy.
It could be a Rigondeaux. Yeah, Rigondeaux is speedy and slick, and you know, well, this guy was action packed. You know,
yeah, yeah. That's the thing about Riggo, is as much as, see, and I think that's what I was going to say. I was going to, you know, argue about Arturo Gatti. Is, I guess my Hall of Fame idea of the Hall of Fame is a little snootier, a little snobbier. I would not have Gatti in there.
I know. You and I had this discussion on air one time about it. You didn't, but you didn't think that Riddick Bowe or Boom Boom Mancini should have gotten in either. You know?
Yeah, even Riddick Bowe, as much as I like him, I don't think he, I don't know. The Holyfield win is his only real cred.
You shouldn't get into the Hall of Fame with what you could have done. You know what I mean? And what you should have done. Right, right. Title bout championship computer game. Who'd you put Pistol Pete in with?
I put him in against number one on BillyCBoxing.com at bantamweight. Just like same guy, same character that we put Panama Al Brown in the other last week or 2 weeks ago, whenever that was. Shinsuke Yamanaka, and the first time they fought, Yamanaka defeats him in a lopsided unanimous decision. It's interesting. I actually noticed that I think the game might actually, it must pull info from BoxRec, because there was, the reason why I caught it was there had been one of Sandstall's, in one of his fights, he had been called for thrashing. That word sort of caught my eye, and, you know, it's like a foul, and that came up in one of the rounds in the title bout championship boxing game. He didn't lose a point, but he got a warning for thrashing. And so it must definitely pull some info from real-life occasions, because that is in, you could find that comment in the BoxRec you know, BoxRec tells you little details about the fights.
Right.
But so Yamanaka wins 117-111, 116-113, and 115-113, a unanimous decision. When they fight 100 times, Yamanaka gets the best of him.
Hmm.
And Pete Sanstol ends up with a record of 43 victories, 47 defeats, and 10 draws. He only scores 8 knockouts in his 43 wins. But Yamanaka, even we're talking light, feather-fisted gentleman here, scored only 4 knockouts in his 47 victories.
That makes sense, because Pete Sanstol never was knocked out. So
there you go.
Pete Sanstol, former world bantamweight champion, not in the Hall of Fame, but I believe he should be. According to BoxRec, he's 110 years old, even though we know that he passed away in 1982 at 76, you said, right? He had a career record, 96 wins, 27 coming by knockout. He lost 6. He had 8 draws. He also fought in the newspaper decision era, where he picked up another 3 wins. He had a total of 113 fights throughout his career with a 24% knockout ratio. Pistol Pete, although that wasn't his nickname, like Alex said, Baby Cyclone and Blonde Tiger Pete Sanstol. Pistol Pete just sounds so much better. But anyway, Pete Sanstol, our blast from the past this week. As usual, Alex, great job. We're going to take a short break. You're going to stick around because you know what we got to talk about after the break here. We got a couple of interesting things to speak about.
The animals?
About. Yeah, about the animals. I mean, you were accusing several fighters who weren't gay that were gay.
So everybody's coming out loud.
Yeah. So, this is parallel to that. So Alex and I will be back in about 2.